My very special guests on the show will be Debbie Harry and Chris Stein from Blondie. Amazing. I'd love to know if you're a fan and if you've seen them live. They've been going for 50 years now, and I saw them at Peace Hall in Halifax on Friday night last week, and they were so great. So great, so fresh, 50 years down the line. And these days, with added Glenn Matlock from the Sex Pistols, Clem Burke's drumming was off the scale. Masterclass stuff. And Debbie, what an icon. Are you a fan? Ever seen Blondie live? WhatsApp 03700 100 600, text 64046. The Mary Chain, and that was Far Gone, and out it's 10 past 6. And Rogers in New York City with the most wow Blondie story here. Chris, I saw Blondie several times in 1977 and 1978 at CBGB's, and they were fantastic, and I've been a big fan ever since. But Roger says, my most precious memory of Debbie Harry and Chris Stein occurred the day before Christmas in 1991. That story from Roger, whoa. After this by Orlando Weeks. This features Rian from Wet Leg. Orlando Weeks with Brian from Wet Leg. And that was Dig on Six Music. So, Roger in New York City with this. I saw Blondie several times in 1977 and 78 at CBGB's. They were fantastic. And I've been a big fan ever since. But my most precious memory of Debbie Harry and Chris Stein occurred the day before Christmas in 1991. I had a small curio shop in Greenwich Village and arrived to find Debbie Harry sitting on a stool and running the cash register waiting on customers. I asked where the regular staff were, and she replied, "Don't worry, hun, I used to be a cashier." I was floored, and she stayed and ran the register for 5 hours. It was the best day I have ever had. Awesome story. Thank you, Roger. Got a Blondie story? It doesn't have to be quite as good as Roger's. At WhatsApp 03700 100 600, text 64046. Hello, Francis in Hove, who says, Chris, I saw Blondie at an outdoor gig a few years ago. It was absolutely bucketing down. Debbie came on in a Mac and wellies, and in seconds, everyone was dancing in the rain. And as always, Clem was brilliant. We're usually 7 o'clock club, but set the alarm early because I'm so excited that they're on the show. Debbie and Chris are going to be with me in about 15 minutes. Andrew in Colville, good morning. I saw Blondie at Kendall Calling in 2011. Great show. I'm not sure how I did it. Well, I do, but I'm not telling you. But I managed to get myself into the backstage area. I mingled around and spoke with two young journalists for a student magazine. We found Blondie's tour bus. Chris Stein spoke to us and gave us some drinks. And randomly, a banana. Great times. Debbie and Chris with me really soon here on Six Music this morning. This is Debbie in Nottingham. Good morning. The first gig I ever went to was Blondie in March of 1978. I was 14. Went with a friend from school, Mark Mason. Where is he now, our Mark Mason? Debbie Harry told the crowd we were so... can I say this?
I wouldn't.
No. Without it, though, the end won't make sense. Debbie Harry told the crowd we were so English. I always wondered what she meant. Work it out. And Alan's in Cumbria. I was so obsessed with Blondie as a teenage adolescent that I had a whole wall in my bedroom plastered with pictures of Debbie. Even the tiny gaps in between were filled with tiny pictures cut out of magazines. And Grant in Edinburgh, looking forward to the Blondie chat this morning. Chris, I'm a lifelong fan since 1978. What a band, what songs, and what a front woman in Debbie. 20 plus shows for me. I saw them last Friday at the Peace Hall in Halifax, and it was a sensational show. Delighted that Debbie and Chris from Blondie will be with me after Supergrass is Caught by the Fuzz here on Six Music. My guests on the show this morning are both icons. They started their band in 1974 and have stayed right at the top of their game for 50 incredible years. Blondie. I saw them live last Friday and it was one of the best rock and roll shows I've ever seen. It's my absolute pleasure now to welcome Debbie Harry and Chris Stein to Six Music. Good morning, Debbie.
Good morning.
And hi, Chris.
Hi.
Chris, first, congratulations on your new book. It's called Under a Rock and a bestseller.
Thank you. Thanks for everyone
who's interacting with it.
Debbie, you wrote the foreword and you say in it, reading about the early days, what we did and how hard we worked actually made me feel tired and dizzy. How hard did you work in those early days in the early 70s?
Well, I think we did. We worked as much as we could, and sometimes under, you know, a lot of pressure. Stress is always a big factor. But, you know, we did have a good time as well. And, you know, it was a new world for both of us. I don't think that either of us was very knowledgeable about, you know, being in part of such a big industry. I know for myself that, you know, I was really trying to become a better artist and to measure up, as it were. So, yeah, I know, there was a lot of stuff going on.
I try to emphasize how primitive it was in those days in the 70s compared to now, just being a functioning musician. It was not, you know, their tour buses and stuff were much nicer now. It wasn't like that back then. I mean, there were tour buses, whatever, but we did tours on school bus things, you know, where there were no real facilities. It's long and involved.
In the foreword, also, Debbie refers to the very long leash that you were kept on as a child. How did your childhood shape your adult life and life in a rock band?
Well, I was running around in America, and I was really lucky to be growing up in the 60s when all of the social upheaval, all that stuff was going on. It was an amazing period. I still remember it fondly, all of that stuff. I was going to California on my own when I was 17, 18, but the times have changed somewhat.
It was 1974 when you started Blondie, and 2 years later released your debut album called Blondie. Did, Debbie, you feel like you'd made it when that album came out?
No, I don't think so. I mean, it was a big achievement, that's for sure. I don't think we were located in the most ideal position in the recording industry, but, you know, it was important coming from the sort of very underground scene. We were sort of a taste that sort of hadn't been really developed in the minds of the public at that point, you know. You know, we were a challenge, I think, in many ways. I think on a personal level, yes, it was a great achievement, and it was very satisfying. And, you know, Chris has always said this over the years, that, you know, everybody's, you know, dream of being in a rock band is, of course, to be playing in stadiums, putting out big records and everything like that. So getting a record out was, you know, a step in the right direction.
You were precursors to punk, but do you consider yourselves punks, Debbie first?
Well, I think that we were, you know, a little bit ahead of it, as you said. But I think what the punkness about us was more about the lyric content than the musical content. Though we did have a lot of, you know, aggressive little rock songs.
They always say the first two Rolling Stones albums are completely punk. But I identify with the punk sensibility, you know, the do-it-yourself stuff and the aggression and to fight the system sensibility.
I think some of the content for me was about women's rights and sexual freedoms and stuff.
How big an influence was New York disco on what you were doing in the mid-70s around the time of your first record, Debbie?
I think that it was a lot of fun, and there was some great music coming out, and we both enjoyed a variety of styles of music, as you know, very evident and the things that we did on Blondie albums. So, you know, to sort of bridge the gap and to, like, art is like that, you know, art tells a story and absorbs what's going on and reflects something of your own interpretation. And I think that's what we did. And I really like that.
I liked R&B, and it was an extension of R&B for me at the time.
And I guess the clubs of New York City in the mid-late 70s were all incredible creative spaces. Could you tell me a bit about your favourite places to hang out and why? The assumption being, of course, that you were a CBGB's band, but I imagine, Chris, that you were far wider in your cultural tastes.
Yeah, but there wasn't really that much going on. I think there was the Loft may have been going on. downtown, but it was pretty limited. It wasn't, you know, the club scene didn't full on explode till later in the 80s with all that stuff. Well, I'm trying to remember the name, like the Cobra and all that stuff. I guess those guys played disco there, and we would go to some of those things. A lot of them were illegal. They would get raided and stuff.
Yeah, they didn't last long.
Did you love the parties, Debbie?
Well, yeah. I mean, you know, it was fun. You know, we were night crawlers to a certain degree, and, you know, it was part of what was going on. As Chris said, there wasn't really a great deal going on. It was, you know, very downtown, but it was fun, you know.
Yeah. When Parallel Lines came out, that seemed to bring together a lot of the genres that you've mentioned, the genres that you were into. Debbie, how did the success of that album change your life?
Well, yeah, that was pretty major. That was sort of when we really became a name, you know, sort of much more marketable on that in that respect. And that was why Mike Chapman came on the scene, and our sort of relationship with the record company became much more valuable. So we went with it, of course.
Chris, do you feel like that album changed your life?
Yeah, but it was just a constant flow of change, as it were. So, but certainly the song Hard Glass really kicked off a lot of things for us.
Debbie and Chris, please stay with me. And let's talk some more after something from Parallel Lines. I'm not going to play Heart of Glass. I am going to play, though, this One Way or Another on Six Music. One Way or Another by Blondie, and I am delighted that Debbie and Chris from the band are with me here on Six Music right now. Chris's critically acclaimed new book, Under a Rock, has just come out, detailing the rise and rise of the band as well, Chris, as chaotic times for you. How much did those times take their toll on you?
I had a pretty crazy existence. I think one of the reviews mentioned how odd it was for somebody to go into a rock band to calm down. So, I mean, things were kind of, I was always in that kind of mode of being weird. But the band thing was pretty concentrated. All our energies were devoted to everything surrounding it. So, it was stressful, certainly.
You don't tour with the band anymore, but when you did you have fun on the road?
Yeah, I always enjoy the show and interacting with people. I mean, that's the great part about it. The hotel rooms and airplanes get to be a drag.
Debbie, have you enjoyed 50 years of touring?
As Chris said, you know, I agree. You know, the payoff is playing music and, you know, seeing old friends. And at this stage of the game, a lot of the fans are old friends. It's always wonderful to do that, but I'm sure you're familiar with going through airports. It's not gotten any easier. And I don't mind the tour bus so much. Tour bus is kind of soothing in a lot of ways, you know, rocking around in there. But of course, the payoff is playing music always.
And can you describe the feeling you get when you're on stage?
Well, it's changed. You know, I mean, I used to approach it with a great deal of panic. And, you know, now it's become panic if I don't do it. So panic is still there, but in different places, in different proportions.
Do you still get the same buzz?
More so, I think. Even more so, because I think I have a better overview about it. I think that's one of the things that I always appreciated about Chris, was that he always has a good perspective and sort of an overview of things. I've sort of only recently was able to develop that a little bit.
It seems like you've always been surrounded by stars as an outsider looking in. The likes of Warhol, Basquiat, Bowie, and Glenn Matlock from the Sex Pistols currently playing bass for you. Is your success, all the stars and the worldwide adoration, Debbie, is it what you were put on the planet to do and enjoy?
Wouldn't know.
Yeah.
I wouldn't know, really.
You'd have to ask God. So. Yeah. But it seems like that.
I think that, you know, it's very funny. But recently we're talking about how you have a sort of feeling that you carry with you. And my feeling that I had always had as a child was that I was being watched.
Is it remarkable, Chris, that the two of you are still best friends all these years later?
Well, it's probably a little more remarkable that people from bands wind up not speaking to each other and hating each other. I mean, after going through all that stuff, it's such a unique experience. It seems inevitable that it would bring people closer together to a certain extent.
Debbie, is it remarkable that the two of you still love each other so much?
I don't think so. I mean, I feel like very lucky that, you know, Chris and I have a great big place in my heart for him. I wouldn't want to lose that in any way.
I saw you play at the Peace Hall in Halifax on Friday night, and it really was one of the best rock and roll shows I've ever seen. How was it for you, Debbie?
It was wonderful. I had such a wonderful time. The audience was so receptive, and it was just a lot of fun. It was like a big party for me.
50 years in, do you have any plans to call it a day, or will you keep on keeping on?
Well, you know, there are moments when I, you know, wonder, but I don't want to look foolish, you know, being this old lady up there trying to, you know, act like a teenager. But it's my treat, it's my thrill, you know, that I get to do music. So I guess they're going to have to drag me off kicking and screaming.
Maybe I hear there's talk of possibly a new album, Chris.
Yeah, well, it's been in the can. It's just being mixed. And I guess this year, is that the idea?
Next spring? Yeah, next spring. I could foresee, I would possibly foresee, you know, working on a couple more tracks for it. I would like that. I always like to record and write. So if we've got the time, that would be nice. We'll see.
I love that there's still that lust to continue making music. That's still very much there, isn't it?
Yeah. No, I enjoy the recording process. I always did that. I hope to always be involved in that.
It's very satisfying to, you know, to come up with something, and there's nothing really like it. When I complete a lyric or a vocal and feel good about it, I say, yeah, okay. You know, it's a justification.
Debbie, Harry and Chris Stein, thank you so much. Chris's often hair-raising new book, Under a Rock, is out now. Thank you, Debbie, Harry and Chris Stein.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Royal Otis, and that's Clawfoot. Thank you so much to Debbie and Chris from Blondie for being here with me on Six Music this morning. Wow. Just wow.
This is BBC Radio Six Music.
Here on Six Music on the radio, on BBC Sounds, and on your smart speaker. Earlier, Debbie and Chris from Blondie were with me. Debbie turns 79 next month.
I don't want to look foolish, you know, being this old lady up there trying to, you know, act like a teenager, but it's my treat, it's my thrill, you know, that I get to do music. So I guess they're going to have to drag me off kicking and screaming.
You can rewind on BBC Sounds to hear the full interview with Debbie and Chris, or catch up later on Sounds. Gareth says Chris is an awkward 11-year-old in 1979. I ventured into a record store for the first time to buy a Blondie album. The record store in Tunbridge Wells was in a basement and laid out like a scene from High Fidelity, with the counter several feet above the shop floor so the staff could do no more than look down on you from a position of superiority. "I'd like the Blondie album, please," I asked, as far from confidence as you can imagine. "Which one?" came the reply. "The new one," I replied. After which, a pristine copy of Parallel Lines was thrust into my hands. Still got it, still love it. Brilliant interview this morning. We'll certainly be listening back again on BBC Sounds later. Blondie on the show this morning. If you missed it earlier, Debbie, Harry and Chris Stein from Blondie were with me. Jay on the bus towards Blackheath says, "Chris, thanks for the Blondie stuff this morning. Having flashbacks to an uncle gifting me his copy of Parallel Lines about a million years ago because the cover was split. 10-year-old me solved that with a few dabs of craft glue. And I still have that copy today. An amazing album, and great to hear Debbie's still going strong." Catch up with Debbie and Chris from Blondie on BBC Sounds.